Good morning, everybody. Are you damn
hello
today? Because it's episode 100.
The centennial-versary.
El Santo.
El Santo. Hey.
Woo. Hello from Florida. What's up, people from Florida? That's what's up.
Orlando. MIA.
Missing in action.
That's right.
How's it going, Chris?
Keep talking like that.
Hey, gang. Welcome, everybody. Wednesday morning for those of us in the Eastern time zone and westward. Other time zones, it's Wednesday something. It might even be, what is it? Might even be Thursday something, depending
I'm
where
sure
you are.
Thursday somewhere, yeah.
It's Thursday somewhere. That's our new drinking. all the jokes about losing track of what day of the week. It's Thursday somewhere. Yeah, exactly. Nice one. Good morning, gang. As Brent Sine indicated, this is our 100th episode, our centennial anniversary. I don't know. I mean, we started this, what, 3 years ago now? 2 years ago? 2 years. I don't know. Anyway.
I feel like we already celebrated 2 years, so it's got to be three, right?
Yeah, well, we're into our third year.
Great. Sierra, are you here? Can we get a date check on that, Sierra?
Yeah. Someone will have to remind us. Yeah. No kidding. So thanks so much for joining us here today, guys. It's a big prize day. We didn't think of a prize, though, did we? We didn't think of a contest or something. That was short-sighted of us.
Well, bummer. Next time.
Next time we hit 100, we'll do that. We'll do a contest.
Indeed, something like that. Hey, we got a guest this morning, Chris. Who are we talking to today?
We have Alexander, not salsa, Salas.
Hey, what's going on, guys? Good work. Great work there. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Excellent. And Alexander's joining us today from, where's your locale?
Orlando, Florida.
Orlando.
Which is now closed, by the way.
home of Mickey Mouse and Learning Solutions, two important cultural things in our world.
Training Mag as well, for now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Very cool. Very, very
world
cool.
To the world.
Sometimes ATV.
Yes, every, what, 4 or 5 years when it rotates around, for sure. Yeah. When what goes around comes around, as they
exactly.
say.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Alexander, give us the short bio of yourself. Introduce yourself to the folks, because this is your first time joining us here.
Yes, correctly. Yeah. As a guest. Well, my name is Alex Salas, as everybody knows, and I've been doing instructional design and learning and development for the last 15 years. I'm a Navy veteran, and that's pretty much what everything started. And interesting enough, in this journey, I was a customer of ADDIE, and it's great that I'm so honored that we are in the 100th episode, and we're kind of clearing out some doubts about the real ADDIE and all that good jazz. But yeah, lately, I've been a learning developer. A lot of people know me for a lot of stuff that I do in e-learning and storyline. And then I spend my time geeking out with research. That's how we ended up in this conversation, right? But I run an online academy called eLearning Launch, eLearningLaunch.com. That's brand new. And then I'm also recently, 3 months ago, I started going solo, so under the banner of StyleLearn.com. So if you need any learning development or good instructional science stuff, I'm your guy.
Excellent. And we'll get you to toss in various links and stuff at the end of our time here together, so people can track you down, check in on what you're doing, connect with you, all of those cool things. And so we had an episode a few weeks ago, which involved ADDIE. And I remember you joined us in the chat, and you were responding to some things that were being suggested in that episode, and we have the provocative title: "Will the real ADDIE please stand up?" And we were talking in the green room. I mean, the green room that involved all of us. We aren't actually with you in your green room today. But we were all chatting a little bit before we got started about how relatively flexible, I guess, ADDIE seems to be. It's many things to many people, and everybody's kind of got a different ADDIE going on.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, part of the main thing I think we should start with is that a lot of people have seen what I posted on LinkedIn and different areas. And, you know, the perception is there that I'm like, you know, the fighter for ADDIE, or the, you know, I prefer ADDIE over everything else. Really more the interest in this is more to like going like, look, I went through an academic program like a lot of people. Many folks in that conversation, the episode with Connie Malamé, right? We found out you guys said, hey, you know, I learned that ADDIE was linear, and I learned that ADDIE was waterfall. Well, I might have learned that as well when I went through my master's degree. But later on, you know, as you grow up and you start going, okay, can we start asking why? Can we start asking by why people talk about ADDIE? So many people are talking about ADDIE and then many different realms, and everything seemed to be different. So how is it a model when everybody just does whatever it wants with it? Like, it doesn't make sense. So that's where I started doing the research on.
Mm-hmm. It kind of reminds me, I had an LMS vendor say once in a demo, SCORM is the standard that isn't. And and ADDIE is kind of similar, right? It's a system, but who actually knows what it is as a system in a sense?
Yeah, so my research led to a lot of things. One is, you know, I wrote an article on this, and I put a bunch of the links on LinkedIn, and the last article actually that I wrote on LinkedIn. And primarily, if you do a Google search on ADDIE, you'll find a lot of misconceptions about it, right? So, oh, it was developed by the military. Military developed it. And I'm like, okay, well, no, the military was a customer, but not exactly it. And then the second piece is that it's a model. So it's a model, and you know, it's a model, and it's a model that trumps any other model of instructional design. If you look at any instructional design model, it does ADDIE, right? So yeah, those are the confusions and the misconceptions out there. Mm-hmm. So the research, yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, well, I was just gonna say, I mean, there's probably a dozen different websites out there, either at universities with ed tech programs or whatever, that have lists, like long, long lists of instructional design models, theories, and methods, right? And the list just goes on and on and on. And ADDIE is just one in that list. And it always, like, it's a head scratcher for me, because I'm like, wow, really? Our industry hasn't, like, we can't standardize on something?
Well, that's true. So here's the situation. The situation is that it could be a model, but you have to know the origins of it. So the main origins of it is that ADDIE wasn't even ADDIE to begin with. It was five stages coming out of an engineering process. So we have to go back to 1973. And funny enough, that's when I was born. So I'm dating myself now. But primarily is 1973, you have folks coming back from Vietnam, right? And the military goes, all right, we need to amp up our quality of training. We need to amp up the quality of our recruits. And we need to also train these folks that are coming back from Vietnam so they can be instructors, so they can provide great instruction, quality instruction. How are we going to do this? So they went out and pursued FSU for that. And in FSU, you had this one guy that, you know, people know, I don't know who is, yeah, Robert Gagné. I mean, whatever. Yeah. So anyway.
I'm a psychologist. Supposed to be good for you.
Yeah. So this one guy, Robert Gagné, author of The Conditions of Learning, was involved in the development of technically what became ADDIE. But the author, the main researcher and author of this is Robert Branson at FSU. And he did this with another four researchers. You know how research works in academia, right? You got one principal guy, and then there's like a secondary, and maybe there's like three students, like graduate associates. Or
it's always the students.
Researchers, right, right. So it's a framework in most cases when you hear people in learning and development talk about it over conferences, over different areas. That's what kind of triggered me looking into it. And primarily that initial model was, the model itself was going to be called ADDIC. So the last stage was control. Yeah, but that can create some problems if you start pronouncing that in the wrong way, I guess. Addict or a dick, I don't know, whatever, right? So, hey, what you need is a, you know what? So somewhere, interesting enough, is that there's colloquial stuff happening. A lot of people claim this, that there's, that is a colloquial thing. It's just a bunch of instructional designers making up whatever they want to make up. And I'm like, okay, well, if you're valuing a scientific approach to what you do, then how does that work? you grabbing Einstein's theory of relativity and being like, hey, you know what? Yeah, let's not EMC squared. Nah. EMCA squared, right? So yeah, that's where we end up.
Well, yeah, I thought it was pretty cool that you were able to find Mr. Branson or Professor Branson or Dr. Branson, probably is what he's in his retirement. And you're the first person I've met in our industry that has gone to those lengths to get to the bottom of this ADDIE thing. Most people just do a quick Google search and find those long laundry lists of instructional design models, frameworks, and methods. And, you know, it seems to me like that everybody sort of should go to him. I wonder, did he mention anything about how he feels about the confusion around it? I mean, I'm sure he doesn't really pay much attention because he's retired, but.
So I did an interview with him that's coming out next week, here Saturday on Off the Cuff, the blog that I run for the chapter, the Association of Talent Development chapter. And we'll put the links for you guys so you can go check it. But primarily the main thing on this is that, in his perspective, is that he didn't like that it was somewhat, lack of a better word, bastardized. You know, so it was kind of like, and I understand it. It's kind of like you're making a baby, it's your baby, and then somebody goes and renames it and does something else. The interesting piece is like really the control piece, the control. What we have to think about this is the ADDIE or ADDIC, the original piece, is an engineering process. It comes from an engineering process. So that's where the military got it from. There's an actual document he referenced, he talked about, that had the original stages, in a sense, from an engineering process. So the implications for you guys is, if you're, first of all, here are the questions. Here are the real questions. I mean, you know, this is all history. So, you know, in my perspective, it's like, okay, yeah, okay, history. How's that help me today, right? So if you're doing instructional design today, and your team, people in your team keep talking about ADDIE, first of all, it's founding on nothing, because if you're not referencing that model, the original model, which is the inner service procedures for instructional systems development, that's what you should be reading and looking at if you really want to do ADDIE. Now, if you're doing something ADDIE that is particularly, it probably is just something made up, if your team is doing ADDIE and it's not referencing that, because there's no other reference. Now, there's an interesting thing where so let me backtrack a little, give you a little timeline. So like in the 60s, there was this guy named Solvern that he developed a handbook. It's called The Systems Approach to Training. So from there, we start thinking about systemic approaches to training. Mm-hmm. So from an ADDIE perspective, I love for you to do ADDIE if you're thinking systemically, because that will give you the idea of not thinking. I don't know why we're going back on. Interesting. Is it one of your speakers?
I'm not.
I don't know. It's like lips in the mouth. The idea. Are you guys still getting?
I am hearing it. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm already blocked off. Good. Okay. Good. I can hear now. So the idea is, look, if you're doing systemic approaches to your development, instructional design development, then you have to consider that it's beyond the course, it's beyond one learner, is beyond all of that. And, you know, today we have a ton of dilution into that, right? So we have replaced things with things that sound more friendly, mm-hmm. For emotionally friendly for people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think it's about the system part.
Yeah. The systemic, I mean, it was developed, you got to think about it. It's something that was developed to completely standardize the way learning and development in the Navy from a training perspective, boot camp, advanced schools, job schools, approach their instruction. So I experienced this as a veteran, right? As a military service member. And this is what I remember from my experiences learning in the schools. I mean, was it the best learning I ever had? No, it wasn't. But it was the process by which you basically took about, thousands of recruits or thousands of service members, and you took them from nowhere to somewhere, right? So the question you got to ask yourself, if you're an organization, a company, is that what you're doing? So if you're, I guess if you're doing call center training for brand new people that never been in a call center, and you want to make them call center agents, there's an approach there. There's something that you can do in terms of that. But if you're doing a leadership course and it's only for 20 people and it's not really, it's just to give people certain learning skills and stuff, maybe you should think of a different approach. Maybe you should think of something that is not so grandiose on it. So. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was thinking something similar as you were talking about, the scale, and something, and not just scale maybe of quantity of bodies, but scale in terms of time length too, right? If it's a 1 hour, webinar or something like that, does it need the same, sort of structure to come up with what needs to be put into it? Although on the other hand, if we've become familiar with ADDIE, and most of us have a version of it in our brains that we're familiar with, we're still going to be using portions of that process anyway when we're coming up with something. Might just not be as formal. Analysis might be just a few questions that we're checking with people if it's a small problem that you're trying to solve or whatever.
Yeah, there's an interesting thing. There's a comment by Joby Just Chisman that says, the Air Force used this since 1965. We developed a curriculum based on that model. So if you can share a link on that and in the literature on that, that'd be great, Joby, because so far we haven't found anything beyond that. Are you referring to systems approach to training or ADDIE? So that would be my question. Because anything that can help.
Like she's mentioned. It sounds like she's saying that it's the ADDIE model. They've been using it to develop the curriculum, to develop that training. Yeah. To me, it's always been like from looking at things when we say, because we took the S away. This is the part that bothers me about the system stuff. When I was going through grad school, it was ISD. We were learning instructional systems design. We weren't talking about just instructional design. But somewhere along the line, we decided we're not building like systems, and not systems like software systems, but like systems, like big, like larger processes. Somewhere got brought into just the class, for just the objective level. And to me, there are times where I'm thinking, well, maybe that's where people are getting confused and not appreciating ADDIE, because they're seeing it as useful way down at the bottom level for the really tactical, like I got to just do one objective and I'm going to create a micro learning or whatever we call it these days. And ADDIE just doesn't work for me anymore. So I'm just going to throw it out. But the process at the higher level, if you step it up, like you said too, about it being an engineering process, you have to go through, there is a design process and a creation process and just a thought process and a planning process that you have to go through, that it makes a lot of sense that it's just very similar to, why not use what's already been done and proven to be good. But there's some instructional pieces to it. So give it its own name, and that's how you come up with ADDIE. When you look at the big picture and the history that you're sharing with us, it makes perfect sense to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, one thing to mention is that, we have, there's a couple of things to mention here. So first of all, anything based on literature that we're picking up from ADDIE, the parts from 1973. It took 4 years for you guys to develop that stuff. So four years to develop that process. I think the feedback may be coming from Brent.
Yeah, I think so too, maybe. Yeah.
Check
on that. I've never had feedback.
I know. Hey, it's always the first time. So here's the thing. And Jovi says she mentioned something. A lot of people will defend ADDIE because, hey, it has become a belief. And that's why we're going with this, with the real ADDIE, please stand up, right? Because if you look at it as a model, then when I talk about ADDIE, I should be talking the same things that everybody else here will be talking about. And I went into bed that if we asked the question up front as to how do you do ADDIE and what are the steps involved, you would have had 50 different answers in here for that. So that creates a problem because it's a model that then is not really validated, right? I mean, scientifically speaking. Anyway, so I think we need to have a balance between science and art. We could just be all about creative design and not. That's why we have problems when we try to demonstrate that what we're doing works.
We shouldn't be afraid, though, to see it improve or change over time. I mean, even just say the stage in the process of analysis, the things that you might do might have started with a set of, approaches here. But now we've got approaches, that we can bring in under that idea of analysis and produces, better and improved results. So and I think that's maybe partly where the flexibility starts to come in with it, because we also, I mean, it starts with engineering bringing this framework over, but then we've got other things out of, the software world now, agile development and other models of ways of making things and coming to products or whatever that start to, we see advantages or opportunities there too.
Yeah, George says, Alex, I don't understand how it is inconsistent as a standard. Let's do an experiment. So, George, go ahead and put in there how many steps do you follow when you practice ADDIE? Number of steps.
Let's get everybody to do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Everybody, how many steps do you do in ADDIE when you're following ADDIE?
And we're not talking about the phases, the stages. So it's not the analysis, the development. Well, how many steps do you do within each of those stages and phases?
I was catching up on an old question. Sorry.
See what we got. So we're saying different problems require different steps. Well, that's not the approach of the
PA. While everybody's doing that, it occurred to me. I wonder if we adapted our if ADDIE kind of originally came from that engineering design framework. I am absolutely most certain that engineers don't have this kind of problem that creative folks have a tendency to have in wanting to change everything. Are they struggling with this with their design process? I mean, has the engineering design process changed and been fluctuated over the years? Have people kind of made it a little bit more flexible, or are we the only ones that struggle with this?
I probably agree with that. I think that we're the only ones that struggle with that. The main thing is that we have, in our industry, we don't have standards for. I mean, you can feed your social media channels with just discussions about this. I just posted something about e-learning levels, e-learning interactivity levels, and that created a whole commotion. It's got over 6,000 views, and because why? Because people are not in the same. They're not in the same scope on those things. But the primary thing is that, look, when you do a model, you're not modifying a model to your liking. You're applying the model as it is. That's why you got over 20 different instructional design models. You have the Assure model if you're looking at technology. You have, and you go by author's names, right? So Morrison, Camp, everybody talks, it's funny that when you talk about models, you only hear about two things, ADDIE and Dick and Carey's. Or Deacon Carrington Carries or whatever. That's it. That's all we got. So yeah, so that's the thing. So if you're practicing instructional design, that's the question. What is it that we value, right? Because this is not about, I know criticism has been in different areas. One is the one thing that I hear that to me is absurd is when people use their new creative thinking stuff, and then they bash the other stuff. But they bash the other stuff without any substance. So we bash ADDIE because it's linear. Well, it's not linear. It has been iterative since the 90s. And the documentation is there from the Army, the training, and the Navy. It comes from, you know, it's practiced by the military, guys. That's where it's practiced from. It came with the help of academia. That's it. Anybody else that's talking in L&D about ADDIE is making up their own stuff. So if you don't want to believe that, that's great. You can believe whatever you want to believe. But the main thing is, what do you value? So if you really want to concentrate on being able to establish goals, establish performance-based objectives, behavioral-based objectives, and then measure those against your process, then, you know, if you do ADDIE right, or ADDIC, then you get that, because that's what an engineering process gets you. Then you can apply any of the creative stuff around it. But just talking, you know, that ADDIE, saying ADDIE is a model, it's not iterative, and it's a waterfall, and
I think it's important to remember in 1965 or in the 50s or whenever it was officially established as a thing, there was really only one delivery mechanism, and that was the classroom with an instructor. And then all of the university programs to teach people how to be instructional designers were all built around that. How can you be the person that designs the instruction for somebody else to teach? That's what it was back when I was going through the programs, right? And your big project, there was one option, student teacher guides, right? It wasn't, oh, I'm going to make a mine a virtual reality. Oh, I'm going to do an interactive video. Oh, I'm going to do just a regular video. Oh, I'm going to do a game. I'm going to do a, you know, I'm going to, you know, use this authoring tool. I'm going to make mine mobile, and I'm going to make mine, you know, it wasn't, there were no options. It was the classroom, and it was an instructor guide and student guides. And maybe you could toss in a little bit of media. You know, you could say, yeah, included in the guide is a section for the teacher that says, play the video now, you know, that kind of thing. That was right. I mean, those were our options, and which were very few. And so there was much more focus placed on the actual content and the design aspect of how are you going to build it, because the delivery mechanism was already defined for you. Now, it almost seems like the ADDIE model or our design process is totally dependent upon the delivery mechanism that's being chosen first, which may or may not be appropriate.
It's true. Yeah. I mean, so if you start with that, you're already starting the wrong path, because that basically defies the whole process. It makes the whole process null, because you're working towards creating a video. So I'm making a video. That's it. Well, so why do we know? Why do we want to create a video? I mean, you have to ask questions. Why? And what does the business need? And all that stuff, right? So the 19 steps in the original model and the actually existing model of what ADDIE is. So ADDIC is 19 steps. It's not a negotiable set of steps. You can add stuff, but you can take away stuff. That's the main thing. So if you want to do a systemic approach, that's how the systemic approach was done. It has worked for the military over 40 years. So are you going to argue about something that works for the military for 40 years? Or are you just going to create your own science? That's great. You can create your own science, but I'm assuming you want to have some credentials behind that. Now, here's the thing. This is not just a lonely guy ranting about it. I'm not ranting about it. I'm just saying, that's just objective stuff you can take a look at. Professor Michael Melinda from Indiana, Bloom's University or whatever it is, he wrote an article because he did this. He was probably the first one that did that inquisitive search. Somebody mentioned Sam. So Sam is an interesting topic, right? Michael Allen runs Sam. It's an adaptation of agile scrum processes to the e-learning development process, right? And so inside that book, if you read that book, you will see also that he makes reference to Michael Melinda's research. He makes reference to the ADDIE model being something that is colloquial, that is not, meaning colloquial, that is not based on real science, on any science, except that, you know, make the reference to that model back in 78, 77. So again, what do you value is the main thing. But if you are, it's contradictory. It's very conflicting. That's my problem. It's conflicting to say, oh, what I design is very effective, since you don't have a way to really prove it. So that's where ADDIE can, that's where a systemic approach can help you. I'm not saying, you know, ADDIE is the end all be all, but there are, like as we talked about, there's probably about 25 different instruction design models, system space, right? So.
Yeah, I think in a lot of cases, the part that ADDIE, the part that we don't do ADDIE, the part of ADDIE that we don't do well enough, or don't get opportunity to, or any number of things, is that E at the end, the evaluation. It's been noted a few times in the chat that, you know, ADDIE is not technically linear. It's actually circular. You know, it the evaluation then goes back to improve upon, you know, the next generation. You've mentioned a couple of times, Alexander, that, you know, it is an iterative process and always has been. And then that absence of the E, or the barest minimum of an E, someone made a joke about smile sheets. That's the E, right? That's often the job pressure of us on us, right? You got something, you got to get it done. And then you've got the next thing that you've got to do, because there's other people that need you to do more things, et cetera. And so that gap there of actually finishing the ADDIE sometimes is really maybe a place where people start to say, well, what do we even need ADDIE for, maybe, in a sense that this is, you know, we're not doing it all anyway.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, in all of that, I think you can use the idea of ADDIE as a guidance, and that's why we call it a framework. And I had in the vlog and the my first, let's say, dive into this was the video, the chat that I did with Robert Branch. So Dr. Robert Branch, he actually wrote a book on ADDIE in 2009, and he was, I blame him, quote unquote. I gave him the credit with his buddy Gustafson, researchers, that they wrote an article back in the 90s, 2002 or something, 2001, 2002. And they wrote an article, and the article, they make that mention when they say, it seems like every instructional design model seems to follow the stages. And there you see where it goes, ADDIE. Now, the first credited mention of ADDIE in literature is 95 with some guy named Schlegel, that he wrote an article out. Now, this is based on a Google search and what is it called? I can't remember, but it's an actual app from Google that picks up terms as they were searching the internet, or they were, you know, popped up in the internet.
Oh, I think is that trends.google.com?
One is, I think it became that. The original was like started with an N or some mnemonic or something like that, But it gives you like a graph, and I put this on the article on LinkedIn. So yeah, it gives you a graph where the, you know, where it spikes up and where it drops off. So the main thing is, look, outside of all of this, right? Whether it's ADDIE, whether it's not ADDIE, whether it's this, whether it's that. The main point is, like, I don't think you should be blowing up ADDIE on everything you do. It doesn't seem, if we're going to do it right, because that's what you mentioned, the evaluation part, right? Well, guess what? You can't do the evaluation part if your analysis and your design is not important, it's not right. So if you're not analyzing people, environment, tasks, right? And of course, that you determine that the need is an actual training need and not a performance-based need. If you're not doing those things and documenting them, that's the next piece. So my question is to everybody that's here, because I asked this in many places that I worked, am I going to be able to walk into your department and ask about a project you developed using ADDIE? And am I going to be able to see two pieces of document? One is the analysis document, and the other one is the design document. If I'm not able to see that, then you're not doing ADDIE. Simple as that.
Well, I guess that's that should be an episode upcoming. How to create a design document.
Well, you can go to eLearning Lounge to learn that.
Worms.
Drop. Plug in. Yeah.
I always point people to this video, and I used it in an article that I wrote, and I'll drop the link in. It's a film. It's one of my favorite instructional pieces done in 1963 for the military on differentials. And I can't remember exactly how I ran across it, but somebody posted it a few years back and it was brought to my attention. And it's been my favorite ever since. And if you watch it, if you sit through the whole entire thing, you can almost see the ADDIE model and the thinking and the design process that went into it. You can see why they did the first 30 seconds, right? You're thinking Gagne and the 9 levels of instruction. You can practically see them thinking through the 9 levels of instruction as they're, you know, designing and scripting out all the different parts of this movie, and it all works and it all flows together. It's just really, really, really well done. And I don't even know if they used an instructional design model or if it was just a really good script writer from Hollywood that created that film. I have no idea, but I like to think it was an instructional designer that had some input or an educator of some sort.
I have an answer for you on that, because I, coincidentally enough, I was going to mention this since you were doing anecdotal thing. I just watched in Netflix, this is available on Netflix. I just watched an episode, not an episode, but I think it's a series of documentary. It's called Five Came Back or something like that. And it's what happened. Learned a lot of things I didn't know, but mainly there were 5 film directors, famous Hollywood film directors, that created the photo field, the field photo division in the Navy. And it was at a petition concurrent with World War II, and they documented the war, but they also augmented the training capabilities of the military because of recruiting and training. So they made a comment there that I thought was like, wow, this I didn't know and I need to look into more. But they made a comment there where they said, we were trying to train all these recruits at once, you know, thousands of recruits, and all they had was textbooks, right? All they had was textbooks and notebooks and stuff like that. None of that worked. Nobody was paying attention. Nobody really cared, or they didn't improve. So we had to use, we started using film, and that immediately made a big change and difference in everything. So that raises all the questions, right, for today in media, because a lot of people don't give a lot of credit to video, but we're using film and we're using, you know, movie directors. It's like, it's crazy. It's like saying that today, if we had a war and we didn't have the internet, you will have Spielberg, Guillermo del Toro, and some other, you know, Francis Ford Coppola and some other directors go and do this.
I think it's safe to say that training departments won the war. Is that what we're saying?
Yeah. So I don't know, you know, to be honest with you, I would like to believe, and I think that, you know, Gagne was essential to all of this because of the breakthrough with conditions of learning. And the people that I talked to have credited a lot to him. So I talked to David Merrill, and he says that his life, his research and everything changed when he wrote the manuscript version. He read the manuscript version of Conditions of Learning. And I think there's some YouTube videos out there with the two of them talking about things. So just look it up. My main suggestion to everybody is like, look things up. Don't just go to conferences and listen to the people talking at conferences, because most likely anybody can talk at a conference. So, I mean, most people are able to talk.
A lot of opinions out there, right? I mean, everybody has their own opinion about their own thing, and everybody has their own work habits, their own way of doing things. And
you can insult something.
Stuff just kind of comes out.
And you can insult something. I mean, you know, somebody's always selling something. So if you hear design thinking and people start talking bad about ADDIE, they're selling you something. What they're selling you is design thinking. The same with Agile, same with everything else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hey, speaking of selling something, I don't want to sell anything, but you know what we keep forgetting to do, Chris, is getting a screenshot. And even though we're live, I think for 100th episode, if somebody could just like count us down and catch us all smiling at exactly the same time, don't get awkward screenshots. So, okay, here, we'll all give you guys a pose. Hold on. And could somebody please do the screenshot?
I took a few there. We'll see what happens.
Is that my coming through?
I froze.
Yeah. All right. So in most discussions about ADDIE, there is documentation in 1996, what used to be the American Society for Training and Development. There was a handbook written by, I think it's Robert Craig, if I remember correctly, but you can look it up. It's a ASTD handbook on instructional design or something like that, or training. And there's mention of ADDIE there, but again, nothing solid in terms of where it came from and what it was used for. So today, what do you do is the question, because somebody mentioned there, like, okay, if I don't have an analysis document, a design document, what do I have? And that's a great question. Mm-hmm. I think you have to ask that question to yourself and figure it out. What do you have? So you have maybe your recollections of the interview, if you did interviews with the SMEs, right? So if you did interviews, there's a lot of places involved. The thing is, you know, you have to be able to discern what is it that the business need is. That's a key thing. And if you're thinking that the business need, you know, people are going to come to you with a training request, right? Let's be real. People are not going to come to you with like, hey, can you apply your analytical skills and find out what is our problem? No, people come to you saying, we have a training problem. Why? Well, because I was up there and I saw that somebody did something or didn't do something. Okay, so if you just jump on that, then you're building a course, and that course is just a course. It will sit in the LMS, it will have a quiz, and it will do nothing. Now, what's the different picture of that? Different picture of that is that somebody comes to you with a, hey, we need a training, we need training stuff. But, all right, great. Can I ask you a few questions? Why do we need training? Well, because this and this and that. Okay, great. And where's this person, and what are the conditions, and what are that? So you got to keep drilling and drilling and drilling. Ideally, you want to have a document that already has these questions on a general basis. You know, it's not necessary that you're going to drill down. That's the problem when you say, I'm going to use ADDIE, because ADDIE is going to drill down to people, environment conditions, job tasks, all different things. So if you're working in a global company and you're trying to solve a problem in Australia, I don't know if you're going to get approved for you to travel to Australia and check the environment. But hey, that wouldn't be a bad idea.
A lot of jokes about taking orders. Two burgers, one small fry, and a cup of ADDIE coming from Aaron. Oh, and which he qualifies, no ice. Very cool. Probably a good place for us to bring ourselves to a close here today. Dance out of this 100th episode.
Yeah.
The chat's been fabulous today, guys. Lots of stuff going on in there.
Thank you.
If you haven't had a chance to check that chat out. Oh, Alexander, drop your stuff in there too. Your info, contacts, and those kinds of things, so folks can find you and connect with you, etc.
Okay, sure, Aaron. Let's see. Thanks, Aaron. All right.
Yeah, tell us all about it. It's been a great 100 episodes. Hey, Chris, here's to 100 more with us, right?
No kidding. Cheers, everybody.
Absolutely. You guys rock.
Cheers, everybody.
Thank you so much. Everybody.
Stay safe.
Thanks, gang.
Quarantine yourselves. Be good to the people around you and be nice on the internet.
Yeah. Stay safe, everybody.
Bye-bye.
See you next week.
Advanced special effects.